morning and welcome to Living Hope Church of Claremont, Florida. This is Pastor Dawn Carter, and I'm the Care and Connect pastor here, and I just want to say welcome. It's connection time right now, and everyone here is spending a few moments connecting with each other in person. So I wanted to spend a few moments connecting with all of you at home. We're going to be starting a series this summer on House to House, and we're going to be talking about the importance of home. But not just worshiping from home, but connecting with others in your home. So we're really glad you can join us for this journey. Here's how you can get connected with Living Hope. If you take a few moments later, go to the website and go to the online registration page to let us know where you're worshiping from. We want to know who's here today, and we would love your email address for the weekly e-blast. Anytime throughout the week, if you have a prayer request or if you want someone to give you a call, please reach out to the WeCare team through the WeCare email. We would love to pray for you or answer any questions that you might have. We do have a Thursday night service called Celebrate Recovery, where we address all of hurts, habits, and hangups that life brings to us. We would love for you to join us from home on the social media channels at 7 o'clock. We also have ways to give from home. If you want to give a tithe or an offering to the church, you can go to the website, the QR code, you can text in a gift or mail in a check anytime. We're just so glad you are with us, so let's get ready to worship.
morning, Living Hope Church. Let's stand together this morning. We're going to spend some time singing some songs to the Lord this morning. And I'm thankful you guys are here with us. Together this morning, church, as the Spirit was moving.
Well, as the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us.
The scripture says that if we will not praise him, the rocks will cry out. We don't want the rocks to cry out for us, right? So let's praise the Lord.
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm short, and praise when I'm down. I'll praise when outnumbered, I'll praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drowned in. As long as I'm breathing, I got.
Praise 'cause you're true. Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise.
I'll praise 'cause you're sovereign. Praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise 'cause you're faithful. I'll praise 'cause you're true. Praise 'cause there's nobody.
Awesome to be with you guys this Sunday morning. We have something special. If you look right in the seat in front of you, it's called a Connect card. And before we're seated, if you can grab that and fill that out, we'd love to stay connected. All right, please have a seat.
Yeah.
At Living Hope, we value the table, and your seat at it is crucial for learning and growing. So, pull up a chair and stay after service on August 18th and 25th. Come hear about opportunities to connect while growing in your faith, being in mission, and serving. If your group, mission, or ministry would like to host a table at the Chair Fair, grab a handout on your way out. Have you experienced a loss? Grieving is a process. You don't have to go through life's most difficult experiences alone. Grief Share Group is here for you. Join us starting August 18th from 5 to 6:30 in the social hall. The children's ministry is on the move into bigger spaces, and you're invited to come check them out. Hope Kids will be hosting an open house, so come on by and see what our kids get to experience and enjoy. Look for the banners and the balloons. See you there. For all you moms out there, come find your tribe. MomCo is a ministry of Living Hope Church and is here to support and grow with you during your motherhood years. Take a look.
A new season of hope is rising among the kid raisers, dust shakers, and rule breakers who are willing to do the impossible in the name of Jesus. Let's go get ready for Wild Hope.
And that's the wrap. Be sure to find us on social media so you can stay connected and find out more about what's happening in your church this week.
Well, good morning, church family. Good to be with y'all. I just want to give a little bit of more detail on the chair fair. We named it kind of like a job fair, but less lame, no mock interviews. You don't have to be stressed the whole time. We care about the table here. And so we've always talked about connect tables and commission tables and spaces where you can get connected. And we thought, well, the way in which you do that is you pull up a chair. And so we want you to find your chair. We want you to connect with some other folks. And so on the 18th and the 25th of this month, we're going to divide the room up after service, and there'll just be opportunities to find new places that you can connect. There'll be connection spaces and groups on one side, and there'll be missional volunteer opportunities on another. And we would love for you guys to just connect up with the different people that in our church that are already doing mission and the different people in our church that are already connecting with one another. On top of that, we also had a group come home from the DR last night or one night ago, kind of midnight yesterday. And so we're welcoming them back. But on the chair, the first chair fair day, the 18th, we'll have a little bit more information about how their trip went. Rick Suker, who leads the ministry that they went to, is going to be here, and he'll share a little bit too. And so if you guys want more information, or I hope that you kind of come off the passion that you're going to find from these folks that went on this trip, that we'll organize another one and we'll have even more people go next year. So that's all happening later on this month. But keep the chair fair, the 18th and the 25th, on your radar. At this time, I want to invite up Pastor Doug, who is going to just kind of lead us into a time of offering and also share a little with you. So come on up, Pastor Doug. Yeah.
Thank you. If you're visiting this morning, I know how you feel. I've been away on vacation. Some of you don't know that, but some of you do, but it's all right. But I came back. They didn't give me the announcements, and you know, because I don't know what's going on. But I'm telling you, it's some cool stuff. And then I'm telling you, I go away on vacation, and I miss you guys. Most of you I miss. I mean, you know, but no, really, I do. And to come back and be able to... see all of you. This is summertime. And to see all of you, see all the young people. Man, you guys, I know a lot of you are at Passion Camp and stuff, and the youth. It's just so cool having you here. All the babies, good grief. I come back and the church is growing. Wait a minute. So I go away on vacation and it grows. Cool. God is good. All the time. But I just want to say, as I've been away, and I got stories, I'll tell this to you down the road, but I met a lot of people from around the country, people going through really good things, people having some really bad things, but of all the things, I truly see an awakening and a hunger for our God. And this is what I've been praying, and many of us have been praying, for a fresh awakening of our God and a hunger and a desire in people's hearts to want to know God and know Him on a deeper level. I think a lot of times, and myself included, and this is part of why I like to get away, is we can get so preoccupied with all of our world. And, you know, I mean, a lot of us got a lot of stuff going on. And we get busy, and we get overwhelmed, and we get, you know, just absolutely taken over by our world. And our God can shrink down to quick little prayers, quick little verses. Okay, God, you're a big God. And you're bigger than any thoughts, fears, worries, anxiousness, anything that overtakes, that I've allowed to overtake me. So I want to just pray in the spirit for you to be open to how big is your God. Is Christ sovereign and reigning over everything? Let's let him. In a few minutes, ushers, you guys get ready. We're going to take an offering, our summer offering. And always in the summer, our offering takes a big dip, and it always goes down. But I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you in our giving. God has plans for us as we begin the fall. I mean, it is exciting, all the things that God is doing and going to be doing. And as we do that, and as we participate in building the kingdom, South Lake County and beyond, I want to challenge you in your commitment, your prayer, and your giving. Let's raise the bar. Let's join how big our God is. The one who said he's able to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or even imagine, measurably more. God is a big God. Let him be big in your life. Let's pray. Father, as we take a few moments, we just have to say, as we worship you, as we praise you, as we come, whether we walked in for the first time or we've been here before, Lord, you're our God. We surrender to you this morning. All our thoughts, all our cares, all our fears, as Peter says, we cast them to you because we know you care. Take those burdens. Lord God, may we be open to how big you are. Whatever the challenge, whatever the thought, whatever the fear, whatever the worry, whatever's going on, whether you're a man or a woman, married or single, whatever it is, Lord, we call upon you right now for the power of the Holy Spirit. Just speak into our souls through the message, through the music, through it all. We love you, Lord, and we open ourselves to how big you are. In the holy name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Ushers, as you come forward, let's worship.
We'd like to invite you to stand after you've given, if you're able to do so, and we can continue to worship. Just declare the blessing over our generations and generations to come. for your favor to be upon us, Lord, and 1,000 generations to come before us. May his favor be upon you and 1,000 generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and 1,000 generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you. He is with you, he is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you.
Hear your people sing this morning. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Hey, church family. We, the students in your community,
are here today to ask for your support through prayer.
As students, we face many challenges academically and personally.
We believe with the power of prayer, we can find the strength and guidance to overcome these challenges.
We ask that you pray for our teachers and that they have the wisdom and patience to guide us.
Pray for our classmates that we may support and uplift each other in our life and our studies.
And please pray for us that we may stay focused, motivated, and inspired to do our best each day.
We are grateful for your love and support, and we thank you for keeping us in your prayers.
Please join us on school campuses August 4th, 7 p.m. to pray for our schools.
Good morning, church. My name is Rob McHugh, and I am the principal of Wesley Christian Academy right here on the campus of Living Hope Church. I do want to make sure that I invite all of you out to our prayer tonight at 7 p.m., but I also want to encourage you, if you have a school closer to you, go and pray there. Prayer matters. And if you need physical proof that prayer matters, look right across the way at what used to be a parking lot. 40 spaces of parking, which were very important, is now a place where God's name will be spoken every day. And kids' lives will be led through Jesus to our Father in heaven every day. I promise you, we lost 40 parking spots, but we have gained so much. There are some words that I share often with my teachers, and Pastor Don continues to remind me about this, but eternity matters more. There's nothing you can do while here on this earth than to lead a child or another family member to come to know Jesus and walk with him, because eternity matters more. I'm here to share the Word of God with you today, so I'm going to read from the living Word of God from the book of Luke, starting chapter 24, verse 13. If you have your Bibles, follow along, please. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in the word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who is going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish are you and slow of heart to believe all the prophets have spoken? Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what he had said in all the scriptures concerning himself. And they approached the village to which they were going. Jesus acted as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So they went in to stay with him. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on their way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." Thanks be to God.
Amen, amen. I want to start off with a question. As we dive in, have you ever experienced this, where you can't see something and it's right in front of you? I told my son Jacob I wasn't going to give him, he's off the hook today. This is about my husband today. Sorry, he's here. So how about wives? Have you ever asked your husband to go into the refrigerator and grab a water bottle that has Spider-Man on it? It's, you can't miss it. It's like right on the top shelf. And he's like, "I don't see it." And I'm like, "It's right there. It's like top shelf right there. Can you come show me? Here you go. Anybody?" I don't know. This is a little thing. I mean, water bottles mean a lot to us and our family because we drink a lot of water. For my son, I remember when he was a baby, for those of you in baby stage, baby bottles were a big deal. And now it's water bottles. But what about the bigger things? Have you ever just missed something incredibly big that was standing right in front of you? Opportunity of a lifetime, maybe, or something that's really important? Or how about, let's go a little deeper, what about your relationship with God? Have you ever thought to yourself, I'm just not feeling him? I just don't know. Everybody's having these spiritual experiences and I can't feel or sense his presence. Anybody ever feel that way? And what do we do? How do we feel or experience the Lord so intently? This is what this story today is going to unpack in a very intense way. And what I love about how God works, I just am so excited about this, because a couple weeks ago, you know, Pastor Mac and I have been kind of, you know, helping with messages, and he was on vacation and he came back and I was like, hey, I got a thought for the last or the first Sunday in August. I want to see what you thought. He goes, oh yeah, I was thinking too, walk to Emmaus. And I'm like, walk to Emmaus, yes, amen. God wants us to hear this today, because I truly believe, and Pastor Mac shares, there's an intentionality with our spiritual formation plan, with our discipleship. There's growth. And so I don't know where you are on your journey of faith, but I know that we are all somewhere on this journey. And so as we read today, maybe as we unpack this story, put yourself in the story and really be honest about where are you in this scene. And so we're going to go back to the beginning. We'll unpack a few verses at a time, Luke 24. And I do want to say that in English, it doesn't start off very strong. The word is now. And I want to tell you, in Greek, the word is behold. Luke starts off with behold, which literally means pay attention. This is important. So Luke agrees that what we're about to dive into is very crucial to our spiritual walk. And so we start with behold that same day. This is that same day that Jesus rose from the dead. Just picture that Sunday, that Easter resurrection Sunday. Two of them then were going to a village called Emmaus. It was 7 miles from Jerusalem. Jerusalem is where everyone was gathered. Remember, just thousands of people were there for the Passover. That was Thursday night, tons and tons and tons of people. There was the crucifixion. It's now Sunday. Jesus rose from the dead. And now these are two men that don't even wait till the end of the day. They are walking home, 7 miles to walk, to be exact. And that's where Emmaus is. That's the town. And they're talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talk and discuss these things, Jesus himself is standing there, the third figure in this story, which what I love about this is the first time Luke describes and we get to see Jesus now in the flesh. We've heard about Jesus in chapter 24, verse 12. The angel said that Jesus rose, but now we're seeing Jesus. This is the first time he's appeared. He's walking along and they're talking and discussing and Jesus comes up, but they were kept from recognizing him. So I want to stop there for a minute. Luke says they're talking about everything. I'm imagining they're talking about the crucifixion. They're talking about the resurrection, what they had heard women say. And even they mention another disciple has said the same thing. And now we're seeing that Jesus is there, but it says that they don't recognize him. Now I want to stop there for a minute and I want to point out the obvious. They're not looking for Jesus. All right? They're not expecting to see Jesus. They're not walking with anticipation of, oh, there might be a risen sighting today. They literally are not looking for Jesus. He is the last person they're expecting to see. So if you've ever had somebody say they are looking for God, and maybe you've thought that at one time, I first want to say he's not lost. He's looking for you. And that's what we see here, is this is where Jesus invites himself to the conversation. And so they walk up, and the Greek literally says that their eyes were kept, like God holds them back from recognizing Jesus. Why? Why do you ask? Couple things. I already said first, they're not looking for him. That's the obvious. Two, they just saw him die. Okay? They literally just saw a brutal death on a cross. Have your eyes ever deceived you before? Have you ever like had trouble reading something as you age or maybe? But seriously, they just saw him die. Their brain is not going to conceptualize this. Well, he's going to be walking around. That's just not something that happens. So there's that. But there's two bigger points that I want to pick up. First, and maybe this is where you are today, and maybe it's not, but this could be some of you. I think that Jesus wanted them to speak their honest hearts. Do you think they're going to be honest if they knew it was Jesus? Well, I know for me, and I know Pastor Doug, I can't wait to hear your stories because I know you've had these stories because I've had these experiences where everyone in Claremont pretty much knows I'm Pastor Dawn and I go anywhere, but I love going on vacation and I'm talking to people, they don't know who I am and they're just being very colorful with their language and they're just being themselves and I love it. And then they're like, what do you do for a living? And I say, I'm a pastor. And the look I get, right? And people are like, oh, I'm sorry. And everything changes in the conversation. So sometimes I don't even tell them. You know, I'm just like, oh, yeah, I'm just doing stuff. I don't know. I don't tell them. But sometimes. But I want to answer this question for anyone that this might be you right now. There is something very powerful about being honest. There is a healing process that has to happen. And I know this because I've done many, and there are many funerals coming up, and I know this is part of life, and there is a lot of grief. That's why we're doing Grief Share 3 times a year. We have that class coming up. And tonight, even, if you want to learn how to teach or lead Grief Share, there's a leader information meeting at 5 o'clock, so I want you to be aware of that, because there is something to naming and feeling our grief, okay? So I want you to know that that's why we even have all these support groups, because there is a healing value to being honest, to saying, I am sad, or I am angry. It's okay to feel that way. Kids that are here, you know, it really is okay. You just can't be like throwing things, okay? Adults, you can't be throwing things, okay? But it really is a part of a healing process. I really do believe, this is me personally, I really believe that Jesus wants these two people, these disciples that he cares about, he wants them to be honest, to have this time of processing, because that's what they're doing. If you've ever had an experience, if you've ever witnessed something traumatic, you need to process it. That's why I tell people, you have to talk about it. We don't want to talk about it. We want to stuff it down. We don't want to feel the junk. I had a grief counselor tell me once that it is kind of like throwing up, you know, when you have the stomach flu and you're like, oh, I don't want to throw up. I'm going to try to keep it in. You know, anybody do that? And you just got to let it out. You know, it's going to be awful, yeah, but you're going to feel relief. That is the grief cycle. And I really believe Jesus wanted to hear where they were at, to give them that opportunity. But there's a second reason that I don't think God wanted them to know who he was. And I believe this is a even bigger impact on our story today. Is he wanted them to know who he was, not by sight, but first by word. There is a significance for them to first know exactly who Jesus was. Otherwise, if he just shows up, his resurrection means nothing. And what do I mean by that? Because the scriptures, the prophecies, if you and I truly understand, there is a maximum impact. And he knew they still don't get it. They still don't understand the significance of him being the Messiah and him dying for all of our sins to give us eternal life. And that's where the resurrection comes in. And they don't get it because they still thought Jesus's purpose was what they were only able to comprehend, this earthly purpose. You see, they still thought that he was this earthly redeemer. They weren't understanding the magnitude of God's plan. I think that's us so much. We have these prayer requests and we only can pray what we know, this finite limitation of expectation. And he wants them to see the bigger picture first. Because before you can experience Jesus, you have to know who Jesus is. You have to know Jesus before you can experience him. So he asks them in verses 17 and 18, "What are you discussing?" And they stood still, their faces were downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have happened before?" Now, there's a very interesting point here. One of these disciples is named Cleopas, and we don't know the other one. Why? We don't know anything about Cleopas. Is he the brother of Joseph? We don't really know. But what we know is it's very significant that he was named, because that means he is a reliable source. Because that's what ancient writers would do. They would name their sources. So back then, if you had a problem and you were kind of skeptical, you can run back to Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem to be exact, and you can say, "Cleopas, is this true?" And so that was very significant that this was a citing source that he was showing us. And of course, this is where we know how they are feeling. They were downcast. That word in the Greek is scuthropos. Scuthropos. You want to try to say that? Scuthropos. That is a specific downcast, depressed state. Literally, if you have ever felt depression and you are just hanging your head down low, and I do want you to know, depression is a real thing. And that's what he's affirming here. These were two depressed people. And so he says, "What things?" And they're like, "Jesus of Nazareth, he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced. They crucified him. But we hoped he was the one. We were hoping that he was going to redeem Israel, but he's not that guy." They're basically saying, their answer reveals a lot, because they are telling us here how fragile their hope was. And their hope is gone. "We thought he was the one. He was a prophet." And now they've even changed the language. Not, "Oh, we thought he was the Messiah. We thought he was a prophet that was going to redeem Israel, and that didn't happen." So basically, when that tomb was shut, our hopes were dead. Does that describe anybody here today? We thought this guy was the guy, but now we're so disappointed. There was a circumstance in our life. There was a situation that didn't happen. We got all of our hopes up, and now they've been dashed, and now they've been shattered. And some of you are even thinking right now, "I used to believe in God, but now I'm not so sure." Maybe some of you kids or some of you teens, you've been praying and praying and praying, and you're like, "I don't know, it's not happening. My prayers weren't even answered." You know, I've had even my own child, and it's a great question. Why do we even pray? Sometimes I get asked. Because there's something more powerful happening here with that relationship with Jesus. They no longer call him the Messiah. They've lost all the faith. They're finding it hard to believe. It's too dark. So he must just be a prophet. So basically what we're seeing is they have all the pieces for understanding, but they just don't understand yet. They just don't understand. And so there's two things keeping them here from grasping the fullness of what is right before them. And first, they had the wrong understanding of God's redemptive plan. They were thinking right here on earth, their prayers, their answers that they were hoping for were in a finite earthly plan. They were putting all their stock in a Messiah who is going to free them from the Roman government. How many of us have prayed? We need someone to free us, no matter what year it is or what candidate it is. It doesn't matter, but we have this prayer request, that we have this limited understanding of what we think we need. And so we're praying, no matter what you're praying for. And you're like, I really need this earthly thing to be done. And so that's what they were thinking. They wanted him to save Israel and them from the Roman government. But God's plans are way bigger than that. God's plans are bigger than what we are even comprehending. His plan was not to save Israel. His plan was to save all of creation. And not from people of the time of right now, but to save us all from sin and death. You see, the plan was a kingdom plan. And that's why I love what Mr. McHugh says. Eternity matters, I say, most. It's having a kingdom perspective. And believing the faith that God has more than we can even imagine right here in this moment. And so God has more in store. And yes, we're going to have grief. And yes, we're going to have depression. And yes, we're going to have suffering. And that's why we turn to the Lord to get us through those times of grief with the companions of other people by being honest with those feelings. But we miss God's ultimate plan for our life when we are just focused on what's in front of us. When we are just praying with our heads down and looking at what's in front of us. And so verses 22 to 24, they go on to say that the women amazed us. They went to the tomb. They didn't find his body. They came back and told us that they had seen a vision of angels, and they said he was alive. Basically, we haven't seen it. And then some of our companions went to the tomb, and they found it, but they did not see Jesus either. So we don't see Jesus. It's almost like you got to prove it to us. It didn't happen. And so I love what James says in 4:10, if we read James 4:10, this is what he says, that we need to humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. I want to start with a visual and a question that our dear brother Jeremy, he's our co-ministry leader in Celebrate Recovery, and Thursday he gave this visual that is going to stick with me for the rest of my life. Jeremy, I know you're online watching us today, and I'm going to quote you right now, because it's a question I want to pose us all, is what is your heart posture? Are you down, looking at what's in front of you? What does humbling yourself look like? What would it look like if you were walking like this? If you were looking up in all situations, praising the Lord in all situations, having that evident posture that we are looking for God and the kingdom eternal difference that God makes in our lives. What if we were living for eternity and not for the right now? You see, when we humble ourselves and surrender to God's plan and look up for what he has next, that's where something big happens. This is how we get stuck. Yes, there's going to be moments of depression and grief, but if we stay looking down, this is how we get stuck in our faith. This is how we get stuck in that grief or stuck in that depression or going through the motions or missing what the Lord has for us right now. And so he gives them a way to open their eyes, not visibly yet, but instead he points to the scriptures and all the scriptures that literally point to himself. And he says to them, verse 25, how foolish are you, how slow to believe. All the prophets have been speaking. Did the Messiah not have to suffer these things and enter his glory? And he scolds them. And what he's basically showing them is the Messiah didn't come to be victorious like a military leader and cause others to suffer, but he came through his own suffering. And so beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in his scriptures concerning himself. I don't know what all the scriptures were that he actually quoted. I'm sure he went through a bird's eye view of the Old Testament. I'm sure he started with Genesis about the descendant of Eve who's going to crush the serpent, and Noah's Ark, who showed us what God's judgment is like against sin and that we need to rescue only what he provides. Abraham shows us the type of faith we need to have and to believe in God and his promises. Abraham's son, Isaac, went up the mountain, the same mountain that Jesus gets crucified on. He goes up to be a sacrifice. Joseph betrayed by his brothers, and Jesus was betrayed by disciples. Moses almost killed by an evil king when he was a baby, just like Jesus was almost killed. And the whole sacrificial system of sheep and cows point to the need for a lasting sacrifice. Samson gave his life to rescue people, and so did Jesus. King David, a good and imperfect king, prefigures Jesus, the perfect king. The list goes on and on and on. And so, when you can't see Jesus, first look to the scriptures. We can't experience what we don't know. And so, we want to hear God's voice. If you're sitting here right now saying, how do I hear God's voice? I hear that all the time. It's through the Holy Scriptures. It's where the Holy Spirit becomes alive through the reading of his word. This is why we want to tell you to sit with other believers and open up your Bible and read these scriptures. And maybe this is where some of you are today. Maybe you just need to get on the road to begin with. Maybe you haven't even begun your journey yet. And this is where it starts. Before you can experience Christ, you have to know Christ. And that's why we make it so that you sit at tables with other believers. Everything we do here is intentional. In fact, did you know we have a spiritual formation plan for your children? That when you have a baby and you're like, I need to take him to the nursery, you're not just taking it to a babysitter, you are taking it to people that are pouring over your children right now, praying for your babies by name every single day, planting seeds of scripture in their little hearts when they can't even understand it yet. Every single step of our formation plan for our children and families and leading up to the youth has a plan. Fourth grade parents, fifth grade parents, we want you to come to the worship readiness class. We have an information meeting next Sunday after this service so you can understand how intentional the plan is for your children to know these words at their level each and every week. And for those fourth and fifth graders that are here today, we know you're here because that's part of our plan, the path for you to be with us in this place, reading the scriptures together. And so, maybe that's where you are today. Maybe it is just getting on the path to begin with and opening up the Bible. And that is where we want to reemphasize that you can't have that experience with someone you don't know. People are going to tell you about Jesus. People are going to tell you, we're going to tell you. I'm going to sit up here and tell you what I think about Jesus, but you got to read it for yourself. That's what Jesus showed us here. He was opening their souls and their hearts first to who he was before he opened his eyes. And so, watch what changes. I told you already that Jesus invited himself to their conversation. He's planting the roots, the words of scripture in their hearts. And then in Luke 24, verse 28, they approach the village. Jesus continues on. He's going a little farther, but they argue, stay with us. Stay with us in our home. Look what happens here. They invite Jesus in. They invite Jesus into their house. That's what is so valuable when we're talking about these house-to-house connections. Jesus is invited to the house, so he goes in to stay with them, and when he's at the table, he takes the bread, he gives thanks, he broke it, and he gives it to them, and their eyes were open. And they absolutely experienced and knew who he was, and it all made sense. Because they understood first the significance of his resurrection, and they experienced in such a way. And then it says he disappeared from their sight. And so, when he breaks that bread, just like he fed the 5,000, just like he sat at that holy communion table, that very last supper, and he broke the bread, their eyes were opened. They experienced Jesus. Now, I don't know the scriptures Jesus professed that day on the road, but I do love Jeremiah 31, 33 to 34, where it says, "This is the covenant that I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds, and I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more." This is the prophecy that's coming to life right here in this moment. That is the promise that God wants for us today. Think about that for a moment. Having that encounter with Jesus. He is not going to force himself on you, and he is going to be right there with you, inviting himself to all of your conversations. But it was when they invited him in, where it says in Revelation, "I stand at the door knocking," Jesus says, "and if you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with you and you with me." Jesus is at your heart knocking. And he doesn't force his way in. And this is a powerful image for the Christian life. And so, as a reminder of how we should approach walking with others, we're not inviting people to the table to push our faith, but to allow them to present the invitation when it presents itself. But it starts with us. And that's what I want to ask you today. Where are you on this journey? Because for some of you, maybe you've been on the road a very long time, and maybe you're going through the motions. Maybe you still haven't had that on fire experience. How many of you are on fire for Jesus? Some of you have had that experience. What are you doing with it? Because if you're on fire for Jesus, that's what the Lord wants us to know, that we have to use that experience with a kingdom-minded focus, as Mr. McHugh shared, to be teaching our children, getting them in front of the Lord, getting them in front of the scriptures, pouring into our teenagers, helping the next generation to know that we're not done here on earth with our mission until we have fulfilled God's plan for us here, and then we experience him in heaven. It's having a kingdom mindset. And so if you've been walking down the road for years, and maybe you're here today, I'm going to ask you, what is the obstacle in your life? If you're not feeling that fire of Jesus, are you looking down? Are you looking at what's in front of you? Oh, I'm too old. Oh, I just can't move anymore. And oh, I don't know if I have it left in me anymore. Or is your heart posture like this? Yes, Lord, I'm here, humbling myself so that you can lift me up. And how do we get that experience? It's when they broke bread with Jesus that their sadness disappeared. It was when they encountered the real presence of Jesus that they were filled with fire and joy. And it's when they broke bread and invited him in that they experienced what God has for them on earth and remembered what is coming next in heaven. How do I respond today, you might be asking? I want to invite you today, as this is our sacrament of Holy Communion, and as our communion hosts get ready to come forward, I want to invite you today to allow this experience with Jesus to be something different today. It's not just going through the motions. It's not just going through routine, and missing the presence of God that is all around us right now. Through his invitation, he initiates us first, that we would experience his resurrection, and that we would respond with the yes, Lord, I want to invite you into my heart. Maybe that's you today. Maybe you need to invite the Lord for the first time. But my recommendation and encouragement would be that you would come forward today as the ushers, when they tell you to come up and it's your turn, that you would come forward with a heart posture like this. That you would look up to the Lord and surrender anything that you have today and allow him to pour himself through and open your eyes to him and his experience right here. It was at Last Supper that Jesus sat with his disciples and he broke the bread right in front of them, and they watched and they remembered and they were awakened when he did it again. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." After the meal, he did the same thing with the cup. He gave thanks to God the Father, and he said, "This is my blood poured out for you for the redemption and forgiveness of all sin as a sign of the new covenant that I have made. So take and drink in remembrance of me." As we come forward, may your heart posture not be one that's looking down, but that we would just surrender all of our sins to the Lord, confessing humbly that we need him. And may that posture receive his grace, his love, his transformation as we experience him together. So as you come forward, bring that to the cross, dip the bread into the juice, take a taste, and receive what he has. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as we come together this morning, as you initiate the invitation for all of your people, we come to you this morning, and for some, we confess, we just walk through the motions. That maybe we read, maybe we pray, but we really haven't invited you in to be part of what you want to do in our lives with us. We pray that we've been so consumed with what's right in front of us that we're missing what's beyond what you have for us. I pray, Lord, as you broke the bread and said, "Remember, this is my body broken for you," and you took the cup and said, "Remember, this is my blood shed for you," that Holy Spirit would be here now to remind us of your sacrifice. You would pour your blessings upon us, that you did die, and then you rose, and you will come again as you are here with us now. So, Lord, as we come, may we experience you. May we open our eyes to what you have for us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. As the table is open, come. And if you'd like to spend time at the kneeling rail, pray afterwards, bring your praises to the Lord.
thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. 'Cause your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. And all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name, it stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. And if you've been forgiven, and if you've been received, we'll sing the song to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, we'll sing the song forever to the Lamb. And we will sing the song forever and amen. And
It's our prayer as a church. This would be the heart posture that people see when they see us. A posture surrendered to the holiness of God. And so maybe today, if you want to start the path, maybe you just want to read those scriptures. We want to just invite you, pull up a chair. Let's sit together at a table. Let's talk. Let's read. Let's get to know who God is. Or maybe you've been walking and you just want to get to know him more. Just pray that you would just invite him in to have that holy experience with you. And maybe that's today for the first time. If you want to invite Jesus into your heart, let us know. We have a gift for you and we just want to be there on the journey with you. We're all in this together. And maybe you've had that experience. If you're on fire for God right now, I just want to give God a, let's just get, thank you, Jesus. And then I would ask, who are we sharing that with? Who are we going to tell with that kingdom mindset? We want to continue to share. We're going to be sharing the gospel for the next 2 days right here in this place. Over 1,000 teachers are going to be here tomorrow and Tuesday. We're having a breakfast that the chamber's putting on. And so we're going to ask your help right now before we leave. If you are with a person and you're sitting in a chair, will you stack your chair for us? We need rows of 10. Stack your chair, rows of 10. If you can't do it yourself, it's okay. Have somebody next to you help you. And then Chris Dwyer will come up in a little bit for more directions. But as we go, know that we go with that burning, burning heart into the world, and may people see the evidence of how God has changed our lives. Let us pray. Lord God, as we go into the mission field now, as you have spiritually nourished us, as you have opened our eyes, Lord, may we have that expression of influence where people see us and they see the evidence of you. May we praise you for all the things. And may people see our good deeds and know that it's you through us. So, Lord, we love you, we praise you, and all God's people said, amen.
I'll praise because you're sovereign, praise because you reign, praise because you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise because you're faithful, praise because you're true, praise because there's no you rain, grace cause you roll.